Greetings, YouTube. This is the Garage Autonomist. I want to thank New Possibilities for having me on this hangout last night where I was interviewed and I was asked some really great questions. One of those great questions was, how do we get to a stateless society? Now, this question was posed to me after he had asked where the name of my channel came from and what was my ideology in general politics. And it was a damn good question that he was asking. How do we get to a stateless society? And there is no magic bullet answer, which is what I said. And that one of the things that would have been good for me to remember was when I did an autonomous lounge covering how societies would be rebuilt in a post-apocalyptic world. And I provided links to actual stateless and horizontal democracy-run societies. These have occurred in history and throughout the world, and I even refer to one modern anarchist society. So the links to those societies are in the low bar of this video. Then the conversation turned to the black manosphere, or rather the misogynists of social media. Again, I think I answered New Possibilities' questions regarding this lot, and as I was talking, I was thinking about their cognitive dissonance and how they see black women, get this, as a privileged class because they are somehow coddled and might be regarded as a protected group by society as a whole, and because of this, they aren't called out on their so-called fuckery. This imagined fuckery being that they pick bad boys, or they get pregnant by men who don't stick around, blah, blah, blah. Bad choices do not negate actual numbers and facts regarding where black women are socially in the here and now. We live in both a racist, sexist, and classist society. So, if you are a black woman and part of the permanent poverty layer, it means that you make up 23.1% of those living in poverty, with their Latina counterparts at 22.7% running up. If you're talking about a pay gap, black women are paid 63% of what non-Hispanic white men are paid, as recent as of 2015 in a study that I will also provide the link in the low bar. The Violence Policy Center released a 2016 study based on the 2014 homicides where men carry out violence against women. They found that the average age of female homicide victims was 40 years old, and the homicides in which race was identified, that's 1,598 victims, included 14 American Indian or Alaskan Native females, 44 Asian or Pacific Islander females, 424 black females, 86%, that's 1,377 out of the 1,598 of the homicides where the race of the female victim and male offender were both of the same group. Overall, black females were murdered by males at a rate of 2.19 per 100,000, more than twice as high as white females at 0.97 per 100,000. The links for those numbers are in the low bar. Those links, what I just said, paints a different story of the so-called easy living and carefree life of black women. Only these strokes of the landscape come from reality, not fantasy. I want to elaborate more on my answer to the question by New Possibilities. Did I think black women were taken away from a traditional role and depending on black men, and in their stead, they embraced the almighty welfare check and feminism, which supposedly says you don't need a man? I maintain that black women have never left, and they are always the ones who are stuck with the role as primary caregiver of children who are abandoned by their fathers, and that it was the state with their own policies that dictated that there could not be an able-bodied man living in the mother's household if she was on benefit, because if so, then her benefits would be cut off. I said that most of the women I've ever known or grown up with have preferred a partner who was employed, and that they would survive far better in a two-income household as opposed to a measly welfare check. But if you are alone and abandoned by a man and you have kids and the dude you're just shacking up with is just that, a dude you're shacking up with, and you happen to be on benefit, you're gonna have to choose the benefit because there is no commitment happening to rely on that you have a guaranteed part. What I could have also added was that I never saw feminism as a factor of why black women are typically raising kids alone. They are raising them alone because men refuse to raise their kids in any capacity. And yes, maybe after the 70s, black women may have found it easier to tell a dude to step off if they had to weigh out living with bullshit or abuse or non-commitment or anything else that simply just doesn't agree with them. In other words, the harsh hassle of raising kids alone is preferred than a maybe partner who most likely might be yet another dependent. But feminism having to do with that? I doubt it. Remember, it was Gloria Steinem and other white feminists who have said that historically, they looked at the lives of black women since the mid to late 1800s and knew that black women were actually ahead of white women in gaining certain freedoms from patriarchal male gender roles, which kept women out of the workplace and gaining financial independence, no matter how meager. I just wish to express at that time a more emphatic no regarding if feminism or welfare had shaped black women. I posit that the very history of black people in America is what shaped the independence of black women. The government and white feminists are not their masters in any way. And some of these dudes are just sour at the idea that they can't be the masters of black women too. I had a great time and I'm planning on having new possibilities here on this channel very soon. I do have an autonomous lounge coming up, so be on the lookout for that. Hopefully I can have it up by Saturday night or Sunday morning. We'll see. All right, that's it. This is the Garage Autonomist.